Welcome, Facebook Live replayers. I'm excited to interview the great Richard Bliss Brooke. Hopefully you know who he is. If you don't, you will hear soon. If you don't, you're probably brand new to the industry. And Richard probably doesn't know this, but when I got in the industry, his book was actually one of the very first books that was recommended. I know that he's written two incredible books, but The Four-Year Career was one of the very first books that I was recommended. And so when you start in this industry, you start following all these legends and you hope one day you get to know them, one day even potentially like this, interview them. And so we're going to cover a lot of different topics, but I want to properly edify Richard, assuming that you don't know who he is. So first things first, he's been in the industry for 40 years. There probably aren't too many people that you know that have been in the industry for 40 years. I'm not even 40 years old, so he can tell a lot of great stories. He can tell a lot of the highs, the lows. He's been through it all. He's got incredible perspective. But one of the things that I love is, not only has he done that, he's got a wide range of experiences. And that gives him a unique perspective. The fact that he's been in the industry for 40 years, the fact that he's written two phenomenal books, the fact that he was on the DSA board, that's the Direct Selling Association, for 15 to 20 years, the fact that he was on the ethics committee, the fact that he owned a network marketing company, the fact that he's been a successful distributor. I'm telling all you that, you know, all the time people say, I don't tell this to impress you, but to impress upon you. No, I tell this to you to impress you so that whatever he says will impress upon you. I don't like when people say that. I think that's BS because they really want to impress you. So I want to impress you. So I'm going to impress you. And Richard's not going to say it, so I'm going to say it. So I love that unique perspective. I wrote down a bunch of random questions that I'm going to ask him, and we'll just go in any which direction. But drop in the comments, say hello, make sure you're not a stranger, drop in city, state, province, country, wherever you want to drop in. It doesn't really matter, continent if you want to, but represent so we know who's tuning in from, and we'll get started right here, and Richard can say hello as he answers this first question. So before we ask this first question, Richard, how are we doing today? You're living the dream. You're in Idaho, Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, right? It's one of the best places on earth, I've heard. I've never visited. And wow. You're there for how many months?
We live in Coeur d'Alene June through September, and Monday morning early we head to Hawaii, and we're in Hawaii most of the year.
Jeez, I mean, somebody's got to go put in all that work to live the dream so we know what to chase, and I love that. I've heard so many great things about Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, and hope to get up there one day. I know my good friend Dan McCormick is right across from you, he said. So phenomenal, phenomenal place.
I can see him from my kitchen window.
Well, you guys got to get out and go golfing. He loves yeah. Golf. So my first question is, and we'll get into a lot of the things. I'm going to ask questions. What do you wish you would have known when you started network marketing? I'm going to ask questions. What do you think the most important attribute is to a network marketer in this business that they can possess or develop? And what does it take to be successful? We'll get into some of those things and simplify them. As I always say, successful people just do the basics better. But the first question is what's your vision for this industry? If somebody said to you, who's been in the industry for 40 years, what's your vision for the network marketing industry? And if I interrupt, the only reason why I'd ever interrupt you, Richard, is to make sure people are paying attention, and I'm going to put a point of emphasis on some of the great things that you say so that we can all take notes and pay attention.
Well, I do have a vision for this profession, and it is simply to reinvent how the public sees us so that they understand better how our model actually works, and the interactions that we have with them are such that they enjoy talking to us, they trust us, and we just create a better environment. So the way I envision it, the way I hold it as a vision is, imagine it's sometime in the future, and most of the people that all of us talk to, 10 million distributors in the United States, we're out there, asking people to take a look at our products and our opportunity. what could we build? So I hold the vision in the form of a question. What could we build if most of the people that we talked to actually held a decent understanding of our business model and the prior two or three or four interactions that they'd had with a network marketing person were good interactions. Like they actually enjoyed it. Those interactions created trust and they created honor and relationship. And so I hold it in the form of a question because, you know, if you think about the 10 million of us that are out there inviting people to take a look at our opportunities, my experience is most of the people that have ever told me no did not say no to my products. They hardly ever said no to my company. What they said no to was their understanding of what they would need to do what I do for a living. And, you know, some of your audience may have watched Super MLM Man, and, you know, that's a really good way to see what the public not only thinks about what we do, but how they understand what we do, which is completely ignorant. They don't understand it. That's our fault. So for 70 years, we have hyped people. We've lied to them. We've manipulated them. We have, you know, done all these crazy things because we have, as a profession, pretty much been desperate recruiters. And so we take that desperation and we put it on our prospects, and you do that for 70 years, and you end up with an audience that doesn't like you and doesn't trust you and misunderstands what you do. And so I spend a lot of time teaching and coaching people to do business a different way, such that the people that tell them no actually over time are their hottest prospects. And I think if we could all work that way, the people that we leave this profession to 20, 30, 40, 50 years from now will be able to build things 10 times faster and 10 times bigger than we're building now, because we're pushing against the current for sure.
Yeah, I like how you put that in perspective, because I think same thing for me. I think a lot of times people say you can't say the wrong thing to the right person. And I think that we say that because it makes people feel warm and fuzzy that they didn't really reject you. And that's not true. I mean, that's just me. I don't know how you feel. I think that's a bunch of crap to make people feel good, because I was the right person for years and I was approached the wrong way of some hype. You're going to make a lot of money. And I would ask, okay, what's the business model? And they said, oh, you're just going to go recruit a couple people, and then they're going to do that, and they're going to do that. And I thought, that's not a business model. That's a net lottery ticket marketing. Are you an idiot? And I didn't say that because I'm nice, but I thought it in my mind. And I thought, these are my friends. Like, what are they doing? So I said no. I said no to 11 different network marketing companies, given I live in Utah. So yeah. I was hit up all the time, and there's so many companies. And then I was finally approached by a friend that said, hey, I'm going to teach you how to treat this like a business. He said, this will be the hardest thing you've ever done. But he said, in reality, that's only for several years. And he said, it could take you 7 years to figure out how to do this. And I loved it because he didn't overhype it. But he said, once you figure this out and treat this like a real business, you can potentially be done working for the rest of your days if you choose. But he treated it like a business and said, I don't know how long it's going to take. He gave me a vision. He gave me a perspective. How's it going to be hard? And I love how you said that. If we can start not being selfish, one, we're going to have more success now if we start treating it the right way. But I love how you said, let's make it easier and better for people. Nothing's easy, but let's make it easier and better for people 10, 20, 30, 40 years from now. Most people don't think that way because they're only thinking of, how do I take care of my family? How do I make it work now? And I love your industry-wide perspective of just, you know, helping out, you know, other people and how to do it. So, you know, that's great. That's really helpful. What would you say are ways that people can do the industry the right way or communicate the right way? Because you said something really interesting. You threw it in there, and then it was kind of almost, I don't want to say bait, but it was almost, I was going for this bait where you threw this in there where you said, I teach people how to turn their most difficult prospects into their best business partners. It was something like that. That's what you said. And that really caught my attention. So I'd love to know how you do that.
Well,
Jordan Adler's heckling us right now, by the way.
Wants to know what's behind the door. What's behind the door, Jordan, is a Murphy bed. That's a Murphy bed.
There we go.
So the concept, Rob, is, let's say you talk to a couple of people a day about your opportunity, and you did that over a year. You know, you would have talked to about, almost 800 people. Most of them are going to say no. So let's say 90% of them say no. So you got about, 650, 700 people that say no to your opportunity. So if you talk to those people initially in a way that has them experience the conversation as pleasant, as interesting, as honoring to them, then I say they become your best prospects in terms of categories. So you have the people you've talked to that said no, and they could have said absolutely no, like emphatically, no, not ever, ever, ever. I mean, I don't know how many people are listening here, but if they can raise their hands, how many of you said the first time, no, not ever, 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 and then
drop in the comments below. You're watching the live or the replay. We'll go back and look at them. How many of you said no at the very first time you were approached, or did you ever say no to a network marketing opportunity when someone approached you?
Usually 80 or 90%. And so what I think we all know is no doesn't mean, no, I don't want to get healthier. I don't want to look better. I don't want to save money. No doesn't mean I don't want some company to send me a check for $2,000 a month for the rest of my life. No doesn't mean that. What I've learned is no means in the very moment, Rob, that you decided, not me, you decided was the great time for you to interrupt my day and my flow and my priorities and my chaos and plop your opportunity right in front of me. What I'm saying is no, Rob, in this moment, I do not have the bandwidth to process what you're talking about. But prospects don't say that. What they say is, I don't have time. I don't have the money. Oh, I know what you're talking about. I don't want to do one of those things. So what I say is when prospects say no, it doesn't have anything to do with them not wanting what we have. It has to do with the inconvenience of us injecting our offer in the middle of their day, in the middle of their life. You know, it's kind of like us stepping out in the front of their car on the freeway when they're going 80 miles an hour with a sign that says, do you keep your income options open? People just run us over. Why? Because they're not thinking about that in the moment. But the point is that doesn't mean that they don't want what we have. So if we will have the initial conversations in a respectful, honorable, interesting way, those people become our best prospects ever because they already know us. They know what we do. So if we've asked them to look, you don't have to say two syllables out of your mouth today before people know you're talking about network marketing. I don't care how creative you think you are. They know it's network marketing.
Are you open to making
money? Yeah, right. Okay. I know. Anybody ever asked me that, I just slap them. That's the dumbest line. So there is a way, and I'll encapsulate it for you, that we teach people to have those kind of conversations. And I'll encapsulate it in a story that I've told 1,000 times. It's a story that I read in Psychology Today 25 years ago. And ever since I read that story, I changed my entire training model, my entire coaching, my entire building model. And the story went like this. The editor of Psychology Today got on a plane. This was an experiment they were doing. The editor flew nonstop from New York to LA. This was all orchestrated ahead of time. The project was for the editor to sit next to whoever he was assigned to on the plane and be curious about his seatmate. Just be curious. Now, if you're curious, the form of your conversation has to be questions. Because it doesn't make any sense for a curious person to be telling somebody else something about them or something about anything. So if I'm curious about you, I don't tell you my opinions. I don't tell you my stories. I don't tell you what I did yesterday or I'm going to do tomorrow. I ask you questions. And if I'm actually curious, when you're answering the questions, I'm not judging your answers. I'm not opining about your answers. I'm not arguing with you. I'm not even trying to figure out like what my next question is. I'm actually, what we teach at Bliss Business is called being present to you, which is like almost a meditative state where everything you say, we just soak it in. We just get you, get who you are. And so if you, in this process, if you ask me a question, Rob, I answer it directly. Like, you know, my good friend, Mark Yarnell, God rest his soul, one of his funniest and best lines was people asking what he did for a living. And he would say, I'm an emergency retirement specialist. And, you know, I always took issue with Mark on that. I said, you know, Mark, if a prospect asks me what I do for a living, I kind of think he wants to know what I do for a living. I don't think he wants a riddle. If I ask you what you do for a living, I don't want to have to ask you three times. I don't want to go through three layers. You say, oh, I'm international consumer products, global, direct to social media marketing. I'm like, you know, I already want to
say. What do you say? I want to hear it. What do you say?
I want to know what you do for a living, you moron. Just tell me what you do for a living. So the part of his setup was that if the seatmate asked the editor a question, the editor was to answer the question directly and clearly, but not elaborate, not take that opportunity to, oh, let me tell you all my stories and all about me, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, to finish the story, they land at LAX. The staff of Psychology Today is there. They kind of corral the seatmate off. And they say, hey, seatmate, what did you think about the guy you flew out here with? And this is what the article said, so I'm not attesting to the accuracy or the integrity of the article, but this is what it said, and it had a profound effect on me. He said this about the editor of Psychology Today. He said, the most interesting man I've ever met. That's what he said about the editor of Psychology Today who did all the question asking. The most interesting man I'd ever met. So they said, oh, really? What does he do for a living? Why was he coming to L.A.? Does he live in L.A. or New York?
Wow.
What was his name? Now, I'm sure they elaborated to make a point, but the point was that the editor of Psychology Today, who was the curious one, became the most interesting person the seatmate had ever met, and he knew virtually nothing about him. And so what we teach people is to become the most interesting person your prospect has ever met. And of course, the cliche, which, you know, I didn't invent, it's been around forever, you know, to be interesting, be interested. But, you know, there's a whole process to that. There's a whole dedicated way to do that. And it's really hard for traditional network marketers because they're just so programmed to, I gotta posture myself and all this kind of stuff. Well, the problem is you're not interesting at all. So the program is, you know, get out there and talk to people and be interesting and be patient, because the first time you talk to them, they're not ready for you. They're not thinking about opportunity. They're certainly not thinking about getting involved in, you know, your weight loss deal as an MLM deal. That's not on their radar at all. And So, you know, the average big ticket sale happens on the seventh exposure for salespeople that make over $100,000 a year. I mean, that's a 30-year-old statistic. So if we think about all the people that tell us no, if we treat them in a patient, honorable, curious way so that we become the most interesting person they've ever met, and then we just keep growing that database and we keep following up. See, if you treat people right, at the end of the conversation where they're saying no, you can easily say something like, you know, Rob, thank you for your candor. I appreciate you just even having the conversation with me. You know, obviously I'm on fire about this. I'm gonna do something big with this. And can I ask a favor of you? What are you gonna say?
I'm gonna say yes every single time because you treated me with respect. And the other thing is I'm gonna be thinking, the reason why I'm gonna say yes, I hope everyone's paying attention, is because what are people thinking when you're gonna give a referral? You're thinking Richard's gonna treat those people the way he is treating me. And if I feel like he's treated me with respect and I like him, then I'm going to say, yeah, I would love to help this guy out. But if he's not, it doesn't matter how good he is, I'm going to say no.
Right. Well, there's another thing that I do there that actually creates the automatic yes, the automatic sure, whatever you need, I'll help you. And that thing is that when you say no, I honor the no. So what I tell you is, Rob, I hear you. I get it. Not a good time. Not interested. You're never going to do one of those things. So I do just the opposite of what most networkers do, which would be to argue with people and tell them why they're wrong. You're just over broke and, you know, all that stupid, stupid stuff that or you know, call people a hater. You know, I'm just like, I'm the anti prospect hater person. People that call prospects haters, they perpetuate the hate. So if somebody tells me I hate network marketing, that's the worst scam in the world. You're the stupidest person on the world to be ever doing that. My response is, Rob, I hear you. I get it. You're not ever going to do this. No problem, buddy. I respect your opinion.
Well, I think one of the key things Richard does is, what's Richard's vision? He's been in the industry for 40 years. So he's never been doing this for a quick fix. He's never been doing this for, okay, right now, right this second. He's looking at it as creating long-term relationships. He's not net selling, he's networking. And because he's networking, he's valuing the person. He's showing empathy, he's showing likability, he's showing trust, he's showing respect. And by doing that, a lot of those people end up giving referrals. Some of them don't. But a lot of those people end up later saying, oh, yeah, you're talking to Richard. I respect what he's doing. Some of those people end up coming back and doing his business. But it doesn't matter. You can't do things with the wrong intentions. He's doing it because it's the right thing to do. It's the right way to do it. And when you do the right things the right ways with the right intentions, it just comes back. It's networking. And I think too much, and I know this is what you're saying, it's just too much net selling. People get in and they claim they have this vision, this long-term vision of residual income. But their actions dictate otherwise, the way that they treat others. And they start selling people and they start burning bridges. I haven't burned one bridge. And I know sometimes there are bridges worth burning, even though I say don't burn bridges. But I haven't burned one bridge with friends or family over network marketing, not one. And I remember after a year, people said to me, I didn't think anybody could be normal, meaning not be the NFL or no friends league, no friends left, MLMer, crazy MLMer, and do network marketing. I had friends tell me, I've never seen anybody have success and not be that crazy person, which goes back to your vision of, hey, do it the right way, treat everybody with massive respect.
Well, yeah, and so let me just be clear that people have this point, Rob. When you really vocally and clearly give people the right to say no, and you let them know that you honor that, they go off the defensive. They relax. Mm. Now they can be with you because you've honored them. Now when I ask you, hey, will you do me a favor? So I might ask somebody for referrals. We do referrals different than most people. We don't ask people who they know that might be interested. But all I really want to ask you, Rob, is can I circle back in 2 or 3 months and just let you know how I'm doing? And of course, what you're going to say is, oh, absolutely, Richard, you bet, you know, showing, because I'm thinking as a prospect, okay, I'm out of this deal. I don't have to be, you know, but, and you know, he's probably going to quit anyway, or if he is doing good, whatever. So yeah, you bet, Richard, call me back. Let me know how you're doing. So just think about it. You've got all these people and the list keeps building. I mean, think of 4 years doing this. You got 2,000 or 3,000 people in your database that they know what you're building, they know what you're selling, they know it's network marketing. You have treated them with honor and respect, and you get to circle back with them every 90 days and just check in with them. Because, you know, the reason why people today aren't interested but 90 days from now are interested is 90 days from now, you know, somebody they know just got laid off for their job. Or they just found out that their parents, you know, like I just found out, you know, my mom, all of a sudden I got to take care of my mom financially. I mean, in a big way, it's expensive. And these things hit people. Divorce hits people. Sickness hits people. Your super smart kid all of a sudden decides they want to go to Harvard. And, you know, you got to pay for it. Life changes. And if you just keep circling back with people and you do it in an honorable, respectful way, the no's become your hottest prospect list ever. And you also contribute to the entire industry, because if you, Rob, or Jordan Adler, or David Jones, or somebody talks to one of my prospects, now I'm starting to create that whole industry vision where people don't have a bad taste in their mouth about what we do, and they'll listen. And just imagine what we could build right now. What if today in 2017, what if most of the people that you as sales leaders went out and talked to this week, when you let them know what you're doing, their attitude about network marketing is, oh yeah, I get this, kind of like franchising. Go ask people what they think about franchising. Go ask 100 people, hey, what do you think about franchising? If you had $500,000, would you buy a franchise? What would most of them say?
No.
Yeah, kind of an automatic way to make money, right? Buy a McDonald's, become a millionaire. So what if people felt that way about network marketing? What could you and I build if the audience out there right now understood what we did and felt honored, like they didn't feel like they were going to get railroaded in the conversation? I say we could build 10 times faster, 10 times bigger.
I love it. And it's fun. I mean, you look at right now, Richard and I didn't even know each other at all. He didn't even know who I was, rightfully so, a year ago. And now, hey, it's good. It's all good. It's part of the industry, right? Now, you know, I have the great opportunity to interview a legend in our industry, and I've been able to get to know him a little bit better and a little bit better and still getting to know him better. And it's fun. It's fun how you get to share industry knowledge even when you're not in the same companies, you're not making money off each other. It's that abundance mentality where we're going to get on and do an interview and help everybody out. And that's one of the things I love about this industry. I'm going to ask one last question, but if this is making sense for you so far and you're finding value, there's been a ton of comments, drop an amen in the comments, show some love. So this is what we are going to ask, the last question. I've got a couple questions here, so you can figure out which one. The two of the last questions I had is, what do you wish you would have known when you started network marketing? And the other question is, what is the most important attribute you feel like one can have in this business? Either develop, have, you can go wherever you want with both or one of those questions to finish.
I'll answer both because I can answer the first one quickly. What I wish I would have known about the industry is how big an organization can grow just by doing the right things. I didn't know, you know, the first company I got involved in, there were people that were successful, But I didn't really know how they did it. I didn't really understand the model myself. I didn't understand what was required. I didn't understand geometric progressions. I mean, they put them on the chalkboard. If anybody knows what a chalkboard is, 5, 25, 125, 625, 31, 25. I mean, I looked at all that mess, but I didn't really understand it. And it wasn't, Rob, until 2.5 years into my build. And I've been doing this 40 years full time, 40 and a half years full time. 2.5 years in full time, I was starving to death. Nobody I sponsored did anything. And then I went and sponsored a guy. His name's Jerry Schaub. He still lives in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. He's a good friend of mine. I drove from Des Moines, Iowa to Cedar Rapids, Iowa in the middle of an ice storm to show him the business. And I showed it to him on the yellow pad, just like I had everybody else. Hey, guess what? You get 5, they get 5, everybody gets 5. Boom, big business. He went out and did it. I mean, in 1979, the guy made me $100,000 in the next 12 months. I think that's like probably 400 grand a day. And within 4 years, I sponsored 3 more people like him. And I had a team of 30,000 people. I was making $40,000 a month when I was 28 years old in 1979. Here's what I didn't know about network marketing before that happened. I really didn't know how explosive a business one can build with just enrolling the next person. And you never know who the next person is. But what I learned is it really does work, and it works magically and powerfully. And it, you know, here was the cool thing about it. I actually wasn't the one who could do it. I didn't have what it took to do it in one perspective, but I sponsored somebody who did. But then you could say, well, you actually did have what it took to do it because you sponsored him. Well, yeah, here's what I had. I had the persistence to not quit for 2.5 years and keep talking to people in a lousy, ineffective way, not very often. Like if you looked at my stats that first 2.5 years, they'd be horrible. You know, so if you said, okay, well, you know, let's size Richard Brooke up in 1979 as a network marketer. Here's what they would have said to me. They even introduced this way, you know, in meetings. This is the most persistent guy in the company. This guy has no quit in him. That's what I have. And a year later, how they introduced me was, this is the guy who sponsored Jerry Schaub. Jerry just went out and killed it. And so I wish I would have studied the business model, but there wasn't anything to study back then. I wish I would have known. What it would have done is it would have motivated me to study more and to talk to more people, because if, you know, how many people did I talk to before I got to Jerry Schaub? Really, in 2.5 years, not that many. I mean, you know, I've heard you say this, and, you know, I say it. I think everybody that knows the industry knows this as wisdom. If you just talk to one person a day about your opportunity, I mean every day, you just instantly put yourself in the top 1% of all network marketers. Why? Because nobody does it. Nobody even does the work.
And that's 1% of those that are actually active building. So it's 1%ers.
If I would have actually known how explosive it could have got, I'd have worked harder. I'd have worked harder on me, and I'd have worked harder on the business. I wouldn't have suffered so much. And to your last question, I'm totally with Eric Worre on this. You know, everybody else that speaks about it, that people just need to treat this like a profession, like any other profession. You know, I ask people, how many years of education, how many hours of education do you have in learning how to do what you do for a living now? And maybe the reason you're talking to me is you don't even like what you're doing for a living now, or it's not enough, but yet you've got 10,000 hours of education and practice invested in that, and it's making you $100,000 a year. And as soon as you, you know, hiccup, you're fired and you got to start over. So this is an opportunity for people not only to earn an extraordinary income, but build wealth. That's kind of the whole point of the four-year career, is this is a wealth building opportunity, not just an income opportunity. And the two are night and day. You know, somebody goes out to make $500 or $1,000 a month and working a part-time job, that's all they get is $500 or $1,000 a month. And as soon as you stop working those jobs, the money's gone. You go build $1,000 a month in network marketing with a team of maybe, you know, 75 or 100 people, and you're probably going to keep earning $1,000 a month for a long time if you pick the right company forever. That $1,000 a month is worth $250,000 in net worth and asset. So What would you rather do? Just work at Walmart for $1,000 a month, or work in your network marketing business and build $250,000 asset? So I think people need to see it for what it is. It is an extraordinary wealth building opportunity. It is a profession. It deserves the best that they can muster in learning and practicing and working. And how do you actually do that? I think the number one thing people need is they need to master motivation. They need to master the internal conversation that they have with themselves that throws them into action, that attracts abundance to them. They need to master the story that has everything work out like Cinderella. They need to master that Cinderella story that, you know, as in, you know, Caddyshack, you know, you're winning the Masters golf tournament, or if it's a woman, you know, you're the belle of the ball. You need to master that story. And what we have so many people doing in our profession is they're in the profession and they're working hard because they want what the profession has to offer, but they don't realize that motivation does not come from what you and I want. It has nothing to do with what we want. Motivation, the fuel, the emotion, the mental energy, the physical energy, the magnetism, that all comes from something totally different than desire. It comes from our vision and our mindset and our belief and our story, the story we actually believe, not from what we want. So we have all these people running around. They want to make an extra $1,000 a month. They want to make $10,000 a month. They're banging their heads against it, and they don't understand why it's not happening. Well, it's the same reason that people are overweight. Go ask 100 people that are overweight. You want to be skinny? What are they going to say? Oh, sure. So they want to be skinny. Well, so how come they're not skinny? Because it doesn't have anything to do with that. That's the number one thing. People got to master their self-motivation.
I love that. So going along with that, summing up a lot of what Richard just said, and I'm going to have to go back and watch this. I actually just picked up a pen and started taking notes, even though I'm interviewing you, because I don't want to forget some of these things as they're fresh in my mind. But the world doesn't care. I know that's a harsh reality. The world doesn't care what you want. No. It's not going to reward you because you want something. The world, it's not about, there's needers, wanters, and then there's deservers. It's about taking the action and deserving it. I need this, Richard, so bad. I need to make money because my husband's working too many hours. He never gets to see his kids. I want it so bad because I want to take my family on their first family vacation in 10 years. I know this is a harsh reality. It doesn't matter. You got to go out and deserve it. And I shouldn't say it doesn't matter. In some sense, it matters, but only if you parlay that into massive action. Only if you take that inner motivation, as Richard talked about, and you parlay that into taking massive action. Otherwise, you know, you're just going to have a lot of empty dreams, and you're going to die with dreams rather than memories. You've got to take action so that doesn't happen. The other thing I remember, Zig Ziglar, and I may botch the story. I love how Zig Ziglar, we talked about Zig a little bit, but he'd always say the redhead and I. He said so many great things. But Zig Ziglar said, someone came up to him after and said, yeah, but this motivation doesn't last. And he said something to the effect of, well, just like bathing, you got to go take a bath or you got to shower every single day. So it's the truth. When I started in this industry, I needed that inner motivation. So I wrote down my why. I wrote down my definiteness of purpose. I had to read that thing 8 or 10 times because I needed it. And maybe that sounds weak. I don't really care. I knew that I needed it. I read 100 books in my first 18 months because I didn't watch TV at all my first 6 months. Didn't even turn the TV on. And I would listen to an iPod. Yes, it was an iPod back in the day. If you remember those big iPods, those fat iPods. So I just load them up with books and I would listen. I quit working at the gym. I quit listening to music. So I'd listen, listen, listen. Anytime there was dead time where I couldn't get a hold of people late at night, because there's red time and green time. Red time is the time when you can't get a hold of people. And that's when you should be doing your trainings. That's when you should be studying and learning how to become more effective. And then there's green time. That's when you should be taking action and calling new people and making things happen. And so anytime I had red time, I was listening, I was reading, I was studying, I was trying to make things happen. And the last thing, what Richard talked about, he talked about how at the beginning, in his first 2.5 years, everybody knew he was the person that wasn't going to quit, that he was going to do whatever it took in this business. So when I look at that specific attribute, as he's talking about treating this like a real business, having that perspective, taking massive action, internal motivation, I always say I'd rather take tough over good any day. If good has a bad day, bad week, bad month, bad quarter, their egos can't handle it. Ego stands for everyone's got one. They can't handle it. And so what happens is your ego is not your amigo. They end up quitting and they're done. Whereas if you're tough, you keep plowing through, and obviously you got to make sure you take action. You can't just be tough. You have to take some action like Richard did. You can parlay that into becoming good and then from there into becoming hopefully great. And so there's so many. I mean, that's just my perspective on it. I'd love for you guys to share your perspective. I know each one of you is going to have different perspective, different insight. And you can go listen to this training 6 months from now, and you're going to have a totally different take depending on where you're at in your life and in your business. Richard, I so appreciate you taking time out of your day today, out of Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. That's hard to actually work there, which you still do your part. You still work. You still take care of your teams. You still lead them. You still help them in the industry. But hopefully I'll get out there someday and visit. Do you have any parting words? You've already given so much to us, but we all want to thank you and give a big thanks to Richard. Drop thanks in the comments. Any parting words, Richard?
I'll put the parting words on you, Rob. You have been an incredible inspiration to watch your energy and your contribution to all leaders and all companies, your phenomenal Facebook trainings, just great content, nonstop. The group, the networking group, tell me the name of it again, I don't remember.
The Game of Networking.
The Game of Networking, which I think it sounds familiar to a book I read about a year ago in draft form.
Yes.
Fantastic book. And I'm really looking forward to see, Rob, what you manifest in your future in this profession. Because you are, I remember our hallway talk at the Women's GoPro. I told Kimmy after that talk, I said, that's one of the smartest guys I've ever met in network marketing. I wonder what he's going to do with it.
I appreciate that. I'll give everybody my secret. I have cheat codes. I know that I'm not that great starting out. So all I do is I was always taught that the greatest ability one can have is the ability to learn how to learn. That's what Leonardo da Vinci had. So my cheat codes are people like Richard Bliss Brooke and Jordan, who was on here, and so many others that were on here as well as commenting. I just go learn from them. So those are my cheat codes. I go watch you guys. I read your books. I watch your trainings. Say, okay, how can I integrate this? So those are my cheat codes. Hopefully you guys got some of those cheat codes today as Richard drops so many phenomenal, just little insights that will help all of us. So thank you again, Richard, for your time. I appreciate every single one of you. If you end up sharing this, drop a share in the comments. Until the next time.
Over now.